Okay, good morning, everyone. Okay, quickly ask your friends to join this session. Post a message in your WhatsApp group. Quickly, we'll start this session. Yes, I will revise the concepts that we have discussed in our last class. Okay, in the meantime, the other students, they can join the session. So in our last class, we discussed about pointers. We started your unit 5, that is pointers concept. And we discussed about pointers. We said a pointer is a special type of variable which stores the address of another variable. So basically, in order to do the manipulations, not in terms of identifiers, but in terms of addresses, variable addresses, we use these pointers. Okay, many things we discussed, how we can get the address of a variable by using the address operator that we have discussed, and how we can get the value. How we can get the value using the variable address by using indirection operator, that also we discussed. So quickly we'll see one by one the slides. So these are the advantages, what advantages we are going to have with using these pointers. So that we discussed, we said using pointers manipulating data is an efficient way. So if you see here that I have explained, so using pointers manipulating the data is an efficient technique. Okay, and in your functions, pass by value or pass by address or call by address works with the help of these pointers only. Okay, in dynamic memory allocation, we use these pointers. So all these are some of the advantages of your pointers. So in your computer, all memory locations, wherever you are storing the data for manipulation, all memory locations will have their own unique address. So that address, we said it is a constant value, so we cannot change it, isn't it? We use that address in our program, but we cannot change it. Changing the address value is not possible. Okay, as it is a constant means what? Throughout the execution of your program, it will remain unchanged. The constant pointer constant will remain unchanged. So that we discussed, I defined the pointer as a variable or a constant because we deal with these two things. We not only deals with constants, but also we work a pointer as a variable where it is going to store a constant value in it. Okay, so a pointer is a constant or a variable that contains an address that can be used to access the data. So in order to access the memory location's content, whatever memory location is having the content, in order to access that content, we are using two things. One is variable identifier, or the other one is with the help of pointer. Pointer is nothing but with the help of address. Okay. And we said pointers are built on top of the basis of pointer constants. So all memory locations, they have their own unique addresses. Those addresses are nothing but your pointer constants. So using those constants only, we are creating pointers in our program. Okay, so all these things I have explained. So as long as your program is under execution, for that period of time only, you can have the right to access these pointers. Once the program execution stops, what will happen? Whatever content, whatever memory address you are storing inside the pointer variables, that will be collapsed. Collapsing, it doesn't mean that it will be deleted permanently. The address will remain inside your computer as it is, intact, unchanged, but it will be deleted from your program. In that way, you have to understand, because so many students, they asked me in yesterday's class, sir, you are saying we are deleting the pointer's address. Does it mean we are deleting permanently or it is temporarily? So for your information, we are deleting that pointer's address from our program temporarily. Temporarily in the sense, we are not going to use that address in our program anymore. Okay, but it will remain inside your computer intact, unchanged. Okay, in that way you have to understand. So as long as we are talking about pointer variables, they hold the addresses temporarily. As long as your program is under execution, for that period of time only, your pointer variables will hold those addresses. Once the program execution stops, what will happen? Ultimately, that content will be deleted. I request all the students to post their attendance in the comment section. Okay. So once the program execution stops, what will happen? The content will be deleted from your program, but it will remain inside your computer intact. So all those concepts only I have explained over here. So every memory location is going to have a specific address. So that is the first point. And like every other computer constant, these pointer constants, they cannot be changed. That is our second point. And every time a program runs, all variables in the program will get different addresses. Yes, every time, whenever you are executing a program, if you are having a pointer variable inside that program, what the program will do, it will allocate a different address to that variable. Okay, that address selection will be random. It is not going to follow any pattern, anything. It will be random. Randomly, it will select one address and it will allocate that address to your variable. Okay, so allocating the address is nothing but giving the memory location to your variable. Once it gives the memory location to your variable, that memory location indirectly will have a address. That address is nothing but your pointer. Okay, so all those addresses will be maintained like a set. Yesterday I have shown diagrammatically, again it will come, I will discuss once again that one. So here, all these are your characters. So from this character, whenever you are taking a character, that character will be stored inside a variable. So indirectly, that variable will hold some memory and that memory will have some address. So in this way, you have to understand the concept. Whenever you are storing a constant, you need a variable. You need a variable of that specific type. So suppose if the constant is of type character, then you need a variable of type character. Suppose if the constant is of type integer, then you need a variable of type integer. So here my constants, whatever constants we are talking here, we are talking about here, all those constants are character constants. So as long as I'm talking about character constants, to store those character constants, what I need? I need a character variable. So here, a char is my character variable. The type of this variable is of character. Okay, this is a character variable. So when you are declaring a character variable, what will happen? Ultimately, your computer will allocate some memory to it. So that some memory depends on the size of your type. So for character, how many bytes we said? We said only 1 byte for character, isn't it? So that 1 byte of memory will be allocated by the computer. So if it is allocating 1 byte of memory from its memory pool, so what it will have, that memory location will have a unique address associated with it. So that address is nothing but your pointer. In that sense, you have to remember. From the character pool, we are selecting one character to store in our program. To store that character, we need a variable. That variable will gain some memory from your computer. That memory will have some unique address. So this entire phenomenon, whatever I have explained over here, we call it as a variable. So whenever I say variable, it will have memory location associated with it. It will have an identifier associated with it. It will have a value associated with it. It will have an unique address inside your computer associated with it. All these things you have to remember. So the next thing, this also I have given yesterday. This is your character pool. From this character pool, we are selecting one character to store inside this variable. So inside your computer, this is your memory pool. This is your address pool. From these addresses, when your computer will select a particular memory location to store that character constant, ultimately it will gain one address from this address pool. Because all these addresses are nothing but your memory locations. You will have a unique memory location associated with every address over here. So when you are selecting a memory location to store this character, ultimately you will get an address to that. Okay. So likewise here I have shown this much of memory location. So over here, every memory location will have its own unique address associated with it. Okay. From where it will get these addresses, in the sense from these address pool. From this address pool only it will get these addresses. Okay. So the next thing. Yes, in order to get the address of a variable, this I have explained in yesterday's class, it will use an address operator that is nothing but your ampersand symbol. Okay, so to print the address value on your output screen, what we use this percentile P conversion string, control string, sorry. Inside your control string, we use this conversion code. This is conversion code. Okay, inside your control string, we use this percentile P conversion code to print the address. To print the pointer value associated with a variable. Then how we get that pointer value, how we get that pointer address associated with the variable, in the sense, simply put ampersand prefixed with your variable name. Prefix the ampersand symbol with your variable name to get the variable address. So suppose if you have int a, this also I have explained in yesterday's class, int a equals to some 20. Like this, you have one statement. So now, if you simply put A, what that A will give, if you simply put A, that A will give you the value. A will give you the value. Then how to get the address? What you have to do to get the address? You have to put ampersand A. Ampersand A will give you address. It will not give you value. It will give you address. In that way, you remember. Hopefully you understood the concept. Yesterday also I have explained the same thing. Declaring a variable, assigning some value, using the variable name will give you the value. If you prefix the ampersand symbol with the variable name, you will get the address. Clear? So this simple explanation, that explanation with the help of program also I have given. Over here what we are doing, we have declared two character variables, but we have not initialized anything, any value to them. So simply what we are doing, after declaring those two variables, we are printing their pointer values. Ampersand A and %B will give you the pointer values that you already know, because in printf we use like that only, isn't it? So, but when you use %P to print the addresses, we are using %P. P stands for pointer. So %P conversion code we are using to print the address of a particular variable. So over here, this %P will print the address of A. So this percentile P will print the address of B. So from here, it will print here like this. A's address will be printed over here. B's address will be printed over here. So this is your A's address and this is your B's address. So over here I have taken this address, but when you execute this program in your computer, you will get some different values over here. Because address allocation, I told you, it is completely random and it will always differ from execution to execution. One time you are executing, you may be getting these addresses. Another time you are executing, you may get some different addresses. Because the reason, whenever you execute a program, your program control will assign different memory locations to your variables. So you will get the suitable address. Whatever memory location is assigned, whatever address, memory address, that memory location is having, that address only you will get on the output screen. So at memory location selection is completely random. Okay, at the time of execution of your program, memory location selection is completely random. So as your memory address. So memory address is also completely random. Okay. So what is the pointer variable? I have given the explanation in yesterday's class. Okay, a pointer variable is nothing but it is a memory location inside your computer where you can store the pointer address. Okay, where you can store the variable address. Okay, and you can access your variable values with the help of these pointer variables as well. Okay, so here if you see, to store the address of a variable, we need a special type of variable that is nothing but your pointer variable. If you read this statement, you will understand. Okay, to store the address of a variable, we need a special type of variable that is pointer variable. So in a single pointer variable, we can store only one single address. Multiple addresses we cannot store. If you want to store multiple addresses, you have to go for multiple pointer variables. So by default, as your pointer, as it is a variable, by default, it will hold the garbage value. So how can you initialize to that pointer so that it cannot point to anything, in the sense, simply use this null. Okay, null pointer. So this is something like initializing a regular variable to zero. If you have an integer variable and you don't want to put any value into that, but you don't want the garbage value as well. So what you do, you initialize that variable to zero, isn't it? So in the same way, if you want to declare a pointer variable, but you don't want to initialize that pointer variable to any value. So what you do, you simply initialize that pointer variable to null. So accessing variables through pointers, getting the variable's address is we are using ampersand operator. And how we are accessing the value, in the sense, asterisk. We use this asterisk, that is nothing but your indirection operator. Asterisk symbol, okay? Star symbol, in your more known term is the star operator, isn't it? Star operator is nothing but your indirection operator, that is your asterisk symbol. We call it as asterisk symbol. Okay, so this indirection operator will be used along with your pointer variable to get the value of, get the associated value of that pointer's address. Okay, in yesterday's class I have explained thoroughly that concept, how it will be used to get the value from a pointer variable. Okay, post the attendance in the comment section. All of you, just post the attendance in the comment section. I request the students to post the attendance in the comment section. So the indirection operator, how we are using to get the value, that also we discussed. So here, okay, this slide I have explained in yesterday's class. So over here, X is an identifier, PQR pointers holding the address of X. So if you initialize X with 4, that memory location, whatever memory location is assigned to that X variable will hold this 4. Okay, then what we are doing? We are incrementing X value by 3. Post the attendance in the comment section. Nobody is doing that one. Just post the attendance in the comment section so that we can give the attendance to you. Okay, then we are initializing X value with 4, so that memory location will hold 4. Then we are incrementing the value, so the value will be 7 now. Then what we are doing, with the help of pointer, we are initializing that memory location to 8. So ultimately, your memory location will hold 8 now. So this star with AND will cancel each other, because we said they operate, these two operators are opposite to each other. Okay, inverse of each other. So keeping both the things together will cancel each other and you will get X only. So X equals to star Q means content of this memory location, that is 8. Then star P in the sense content of this memory location only. So 8 and 8 you will get over here, 8 plus 8, that is 16. So your memory location will become 16. So then again we are taking the same instance over here. So X will hold 16. Now next what we are doing, X equals to star P, this is multiplication operator. Over here the indirection operator will act like a multiplication operator. So what will happen? Ultimately here you will get 16 multiplied with 16. So that will be equivalent to 256. So the same thing you will get inside the memory location, 256. So this is the declaration of a pointer, how we can declare a pointer. Okay, so that also I have explained. Simply what we have to do, so this is your regular variable declaration. For your regular variable declaration, we are using the type followed by the identifier. This is your pointer declaration. So pointer declaration, type followed by star we will do, then the identifier. So whenever you are framing this identifier, you have to follow the identifier rules. Here as well as here, you have to follow the identifier rules. Here the type, it can be any data type. Here also same thing, the type, it can be any data type, but the star you have to suffix. Here we are suffixing this star, we are taking after the type. So this is your regular variable declaration, character variable. So if you have the character variable and want to store the address of a character, then you need a character pointer. Character pointer, how we are declaring? Simply character star. So if you do like this, this P will become a pointer to character. Here also same thing, integer variable we are having, normal declaration, integer declaration. Then in order to store the address of this integer variable n, we need a integer pointer that we are declaring over here. How can we declare? Simply you put star followed by the type. Okay, indirection operator followed by the asterisk symbol followed by the type. So again for float same thing, if you have a float variable, to store the address of that float variable, we need a float pointer. And then how we are getting the float pointer, in the sense float star. So in this way you will get the float pointer. So declaration of a variable, only type followed by the identifier. Okay, declaration of a pointer, type asterisk followed by the identifier. Okay, very simple thing. So this is a simple program to demonstrate how the pointer will work, how the pointer you can use in your program. First what I have done, simply I have taken an integer variable a, then I want to store the address of this a, so I have taken an integer pointer, int star ptr, this ptr will become your integer pointer. Then I'm initializing a with 4. Okay, so now here what will happen, let us understand this thing. Here what will happen, int a in the sense a memory location will be allocated, a memory location will be allocated inside your computer memory. Okay, when you get a memory location, that memory location will have some address. Okay, that memory location will have some address. Let us suppose this entire thing is your address, so 0x that 7ff 7ff, this address you will get, this is the address, and so on, dot dot dot. I am keeping this entire thing is the address of this memory location. So here what will happen, you will get an identifier. How you are going to identify this memory location inside your program, in the sense with the help of this name a. So this is the identifier for this memory location and this is your address. This is your identifier, this is memory location, this is address associated with that memory location. Then what we are doing, we are declaring a pointer. A pointer is also a variable. Then what will happen, a pointer, for a pointer, a memory location will be declared. A memory location will be declared, I mean allocated. Then the identifier for this memory location is PTR. Okay, identifier for this memory location is PTR. So now, next what I am doing, I am doing A equals to 4. So A equals to 4 in the sense, what will happen? This 4 will come inside this. So here, you will get 4. Inside this memory location, you will get 4 as a value. Then what I am doing, PTR equals to ampersand A. So ampersand A means address of A. So this is your address. This entire thing is address, I said. So what will happen? That entire address will be stored over here. That 0x7ff will be stored over here. 7ff and so on will be stored over here. So if you are storing this, this is pointing to this memory location. If it is holding the address of that memory location, in the sense, this is this pointer, PTR is pointing to that memory location. So now over here, what I am doing, percentile D, percentile P. So one integer value I am printing and one address I am printing. So A will give you the integer value. Simply, I'm not using any ampersand, nothing over here. Directly A I'm using. So if you use A, variable name itself, then that variable name will give you value. So A is having 4, so that 4 you are getting over here. A is holding 4. Quickly see here. Inside A's memory location, what we have? 4 we have. So that 4 you are getting over here. Next, ampersand A, address operator prefixing. What it will give? It will give the address. So that address we are printing at this location. So what is the address of A? This entire thing is the address. So that same we are getting over here. Address of A. Clear. Next thing, once again, come down. In the next printf statement also, we are printing one value and one address. So inside PTR, what we have? Inside PTR, we have the address of A. Applying the indirection on that address, address of A indirection, you will get the value of A. Because PTR is holding address of A. This 0x7ff and so on is the address of A. So if you apply the indirection on that address, you will get the value of that address. Value of that address is nothing but 4 only. So that is the reason why this star PTR will give you the value. That value you are printing at this location, percentile D. That value will come over here. Next thing, PTR, PTR's content. We are not applying any operator, no indirection, no address. We are simply printing PTR. PTR's content is what? PTR's content are address of A. PTR's content is address of A. So that same thing we are getting at this P. PTR will give you address of A. Address of A we are getting over here. So in that way, in that sense, you have to understand. Go to the next slide. So here, declaration versus redirection. For declaring, we are using type followed by star. Okay, type followed by star is nothing but your declaration. Redirection in the sense, getting the value from the address. Star APTR. Inside APTR, we have the address of A. Then applying star will give you the value of A. So that is redirection. Declaration versus redirection we discussed. Then initializing pointer variables. So how we can initialize? Simply by storing the address of a variable. So if you have a pointer variable, put the address of another variable into that pointer variable. So in that way, we can initialize a pointer variable. Okay. So pointers to pointers. This thing you have to understand. Quickly see these three statements. Int A, int star P, and int star star. To make this concept very clear, I will take the help of MS Paint so that I'm opening. Guys, you're not posting the attendance. You will not get the attendance because from your IDs, I cannot tell your roll number. So quickly post the attendance in the comment section. Post the attendance in the comment section, all of you. And if you have any doubts, you can ask. Okay, the next thing is the pointers to pointers. So being a regular variable, int A. So over here, A is your regular type of variable. So if I want to store the address of this A, So then I need a pointer of type integer, because a is of type integer. So I need a pointer of type integer. So how can I declare a pointer of type integer? It is very simple. I have to simply suffix the asterisk symbol. So this will become APTR. Understood? So now this APTR is capable of holding the address of A. So I can write a statement so that I can store the address of A into that APTR. How come? APTR equals to ampersand A. So now what will happen? My APTR is holding the address of A. Clear? So ampersand A will give you the address of A. So that address we are storing inside this APTR. So the next thing, suppose if I want to store the address of this APTR into another variable, into another pointer variable. So now quickly try to understand, storing the address of an integer variable, you need an integer pointer. Understood? Storing the address of an integer variable, you need an integer pointer. Insta. Storing an address of an integer pointer. Okay. Storing the address of an integer pointer, you need a pointer to pointer. So that is our concept. Pointer to pointer. How we can declare? Simply you have to put int double star. A two level, a second level pointer. Okay. So here PTR to APTR. APTR. Pointer to APTR. So like this. Okay. So in this now, in this APTR, sorry, in this PTR to APTR, I can store the address of PTR. APTR. PTR to APTR. In this, I can store the address of APTR. So like this. Here. In this way. So now over here, A is my regular variable, normal integer variable. APTR is a pointer, first level pointer. APTR is a first level pointer capable of holding an integer's address. Then PTR to APT, sorry, inside that I am storing the address of A. Then PTR to APTR is a second level pointer. Second level pointer which can hold the address of first level pointer. Okay, first level pointer. See, you have a variable of type integer. To store the address of that variable, simply put, because it is a normal variable, so you need a first level pointer. First level pointer, how we can declare? Simply put only one star. So that will become your first level pointer and it can hold the address of a normal integer variable. So to store the address of a first level pointer, you need a second level pointer. Second level pointer is nothing but int double star. You have to use double star. So with the help of this second level pointer, you can store the address of first level pointer. So this PTR to APTR is nothing but your pointer to pointer. We call this as pointer to pointer. Simply remember. Pointer to pointer. So like this, you can have any levels inside your pointers. You can have inside many number of levels. Suppose if it is a second level pointer, now I want to store the address of the second level pointer, so I have to declare a third level pointer. How can I declare a third level pointer? Simply put three stars, then it will become pointer to APTR. So it is a third level pointer. So inside this third level pointer, what you can do? You can store the address of pointer to APTR. So pointer to APTR can hold the address of pointer to APTR. Okay, can hold the address of pointer to APTR. Understood? So quickly we'll analyze this stuff. So I have declared a normal variable A. This is your A. Whatever declaration I have done over here, this is your normal integer variable A. Okay. So I will call it as normal A. So this A will have some address. So let us say that address is nothing but your 14,000 1. Okay, this is your address for this pointer variable A. So now to store this address, okay, to store this address, I declared an integer pointer, that is APTR. So that APTR will also consume, because this APTR being a pointer, it is also a variable. So that variable will consume some memory. So that will become like this. So let us assume it is also having some address, some 17,000. 17,001. Okay. So what is the identifier for this pointer variable? APTR. So that APTR I am declaring over here. So this is the name of this variable is APTR. The identifier for that variable is APTR. So in this statement, in this particular statement, what I have done, I have stored the address of A into this APTR. So what will happen? So this will point, this will ultimately going to point, sorry. So this will going to point this particular thing. So how it is going to point in your computer? By storing the address of A. So this address it is going to store. This address will come here. So like this, this address will be stored inside this pointer. So this is what here when you are doing APTR equals to ampersand A, what will happen? The address of A will be stored inside this APTR. So storing the address, a link will be formed between them. A link will be formed between them. Link will be formed like this. So this APTR is going to point this. Something like this, a link will be formed. Clear. Next, what I am doing? I am declaring a second level pointer. Second level pointer, it is also being a pointer, it is also a memory location. Being a pointer, it is also a memory location. And the identifier for this second level pointer, I have given PTR to APTR. Pointer to APTR. APTR. Okay. So as it is a variable, it will also have some address. So that address is nothing but 18,001, some random address I'm taking, because all these addresses will be random in nature. So next what I am doing, I am storing the address of this APTR. I'm storing the address of this APTR inside this PTR to APTR, pointer to APTR. Then what will happen? This pointer to APTR is going to have this address. After that statement, this pointer to APTR will have this address. So this address will come over here. Like this. Understood? So 17,001 will come like this here. So this entire thing is going to point as this a pointer to APTR is holding the address of APTR. This entire thing is going to point this APTR. So this is your second level pointer. This is your second level pointer. Okay, like this. This is your second level pointer. Third level pointer, what I have done? So third level pointer, I have declared another variable. So this I will put here. I have declared another variable, another pointer variable int triple star. So that is again a memory location with some unique address, 19,001. Okay, then what I have done? The reference to this, I mean identifier to this variable is PTR to APTR, PTR to PTR to APTR. That name I'm taking like this here. This is your identifier. Okay, this is your identifier. Next thing, yes, in this particular statement, what I'm doing, I'm storing the address of PTR to APTR inside PTR to APTR to PTR to PTR to APTR. So that is nothing but this address will come. Whatever address you have for this PTR to APTR, that same address will come inside this, like this. Because it is holding the address of PTR to APTR. The address of PTR to APTR is 18,001, and that we are storing inside this PTR to PTR to APTR. So now this thing indirectly going to point this entire thing. So like this, you can have any number of pointers. There is no restriction or there is no limit that you can have only up to this much, I mean, only up to this level pointer. There is no limit. You can have any number of, it is a continuous process. It is a continuous process. You can have like this many in number. Same in this way, this is your normal variable and this is your first level pointer, second level pointer, third level pointer. Like this, you can have many pointers in the sequence. Yeah, this concept you have to understand very thoroughly, very neatly. If you have any doubts, you can ask. How I have done that declarations, how I have stored the different addresses into those pointers. So why I'm calling this as the first level pointer and why I'm calling this as the second level pointer, this as the third level pointer, you have to understand. So this is your first level pointer. This is your normal variable. First level pointer, second level pointer, third level pointer. Likewise. Okay. So the next thing, we'll go to the slide and we will see what we have. Yeah, this is what I have explained. So this is your normal variable. A is your normal variable. P is your first level pointer. And Q is your second level pointer. So this is your normal variable holding the value 58. Normal variable. This is your first level pointer holding the address of normal variable. This is your second level pointer holding the address of first level pointer. So in this way, you have to remember. This is normal variable. Normal. Okay. Normal variable. This is your first level pointer. This is your second level pointer. That's it. So here, to demonstrate these things, yeah, I have already done that demonstration. So for how you can declare this A, take any type. I will take the integer as type. So how you can declare this A? So now to declare A, simply put integer A. That's it. How you can declare this P? Because it is a pointer to integer. So simply int star P. Int followed by the star asterisk symbol P. So this is your first level pointer. We call this as first level pointer. Then how you can declare this Q? Q is nothing but your second level pointer. Isn't it? Because it is pointing the first level pointer. As you can see, Q is pointing the first level pointer. So Q has to be the second level pointer. So how you can declare the second level pointer? Int double star. Simply put, int followed by two stars. Int star, another star, then Q. So now this Q can point this P. So that statement also I will write. So if you store some value into the same, first I will declare this third level pointer, because this R is pointing to a second level pointer of type integer. So this R has to be a third level pointer. So how you can make this R as a third level pointer? Simply put, int followed by how many asterisk symbols? Three asterisk symbols. Okay, because it is pointing to a second level pointer, put three asterisk symbols to make this R as a third level pointer. So now R will become my third level pointer, R. So then this R is pointing to this Q. So how I can make this is second level. Okay. Finally, this is your third level pointer. Third level. So now this is your normal variable A. So suppose if I want to put something over here. I want to put some value over here. Like 30 I want to put over here. So I want to put 30 over here. How can I put that one? Simply, I have multiple options. So doing A is equals to 30. A is equals to 30. Will make this content as 30. This is one option. Or using this pointer also, I can change the content over here. I can put the content. I can put that same content over here. So that is my second option. So before doing that, what I have to do, I have to store the address of this A inside this P. Okay, then P equals to %A. P is equals to %A. Now P is holding the address of A. So to get that location, to get that memory location, what I have to do? Star P is equals to some 40, I am saying. Star P is equals to 40. So then what will happen? when you say star p is equals to 40, this content will be overwritten. Yahan par jo bhi content hai, this content will be overwritten and you will get 40 over here. Inside this memory location, you will get 40 now. So next thing, with the help of this cube, quickly check. Inside this cube, what I have to do? This cube can hold the address of this first level pointer. So q is equals to, what I am doing? Q is equals to ampersand p. So now q is holding the address of p. So using this q, how can I access this a? The concept is very simple. It is a second level pointer. So you have to apply the indirection twice. Applying the indirection first time will take you to P. Okay. Q. Q indirection. Q is having the address of P. Okay. So Q is having the address of P and applying indirection will give you the content of P. So P is having what? P is having the address of A. So apply the indirection on that address. So apply one more indirection. Will take you to A. So now if you put 50 over here, what will happen? Ultimately, it will overwrite that same content. It will overwrite this content and you will get 50 over here. Okay. So now come to the third pointer, third level pointer, that is R. So R is capable of holding the second level pointer address. So R equals to ampersand Q I can write. So now R is holding the address of Q. So if you apply first level, if you apply only one time indirection, this will take you to Q from here to here. Apply another indirection will take you to P from here to here. Apply another indirection will take you to A. Will take you to A. Now put this 60 over here, will override the content. This content will be overwritten. Here 50 will be removed and you will get 60. In this way, these things will work. And in this way only you have to understand. Okay. Being a normal variable, simply A equals to 30, we'll initialize this A with 30. Being a pointer, first level pointer, you have to apply the first level of indirection. Second level pointer, you have to apply the indirection, second level indirection. Third level pointer, apply third level indirection. In that way, you can store, you can access this A in these three different ways. Okay? Yeah, these pointers to void. So I told you that if you have a pointer to, if you have a type integer variable, if you have an integer variable, what you have to do? Int A you have. To store the address of A, you have to declare a pointer of type integer. How you are declaring? Int star APTR. Like this we are declaring. I will explain in more detail that one. By taking that paint application, by using that paint application, I will explain this thing. So quickly come over here, delete this one. So suppose if you have an integer pointer, int A, to store the address of integer pointer, we are declaring int star APTR. So now APTR is capable of holding the address of A. In that same way, if you have a variable of type character ch, so to store the address of this ch, what we are doing? We are declaring a character pointer, character star, okay, chptr. In the same way, if you have a variable of type float, float, float f we are having. So to store the address of that float variable, we are declaring a float pointer, float star fptr. So now in this case, in these scenarios, in these three examples, your APTR is capable of holding the address of A. Your CHPTR is capable of holding the address of CH. Your FPTR is capable of holding the address of F. Okay. So doing this thing is a tedious job. Suppose in your programming, if you don't know what type of variable you are going to declare, but you want to store the address of that variable. The type is unknown to you and you want to store the address of that variable. In that case, what we will do means we will go with void pointer. So simply declare void star PPR. Now this void pointer, we call this void pointer as a generic pointer. We call this void pointer as a generic pointer. Okay, generic pointer. Okay, generic in the sense, over here when I say generic, generic means type independent, irrespective to the type. Generic pointer in the sense irrespective to the type. So now in this APTR, I can store only the address of A, isn't it? I can store only the address of A because it is an integer pointer. APTR is an integer pointer. In this CHPTR, I can store only the address of CH because it is a character pointer. Clear? Because it is a character pointer. CHPTR is a character pointer, so it can hold the address of CH only. Then in this FPTR, I can store the address of float variable, F only. So that is FPTR equals to capable of holding the address of F only. So can I store inside this FPTR the address of CH? Not possible, because FPTR is a float pointer and it cannot hold the address of character variable. But when we talk about this void PTR, I mean void star PTR, this PTR, it is a pointer of type generic. Generic in the sense irrespective to the type. So being a generic type pointer, it can hold the address of A. So you can put the address of A. Okay. Or you can put the address of this CH as well. So being a generic pointer, so there is nothing but PTR, it can also hold the address of CH. And finally, it can also hold the address of F. That is nothing but you can put PTR equals to %F. So like this you can do. So being a generic pointer, PTR can hold the address of A, address of CH, address of F likewise. It can hold the address of any type of variable. Generic pointer. Clear? So the same concept I have explained over here. Declaration. How we are declaring a generic pointer in the sense? Simply by using this void keyword. So we also call this pointer as a void pointer. If you read this entire thing, you will understand the same thing. A pointer to void is a generic type that is not associated with a reference type. That it is not the address of a character, an integer, a float point, or any other type. It can be the address of any type. Okay, it is compatible for assignment purpose only with all other types. So we can use this type with all other types. Understood? So in that way, you remember a generic pointer in the sense a pointer to void capable of holding the address of any type of variable. Okay, so the demonstration I have given over here. So simply try to understand this program. Very simple program. I'm declaring a normal variable, a variable with value 20, a character variable with value a as a character. So the next thing, I'm declaring a generic pointer, PTR. So inside PTR, I'm holding the value of, address of a. So over here, if you see PTR, being a generic pointer, it is holding the address of an integer variable. So using that integer variable, I'm trying to dereference. Dereferencing is not possible, is not allowed. Okay. Because PTR, it is a generic pointer. So as it is holding an integer value, so you have to typecast that integer, you have to typecast the generic pointer with integer pointer. So this phenomenon, we call it as typecasting. We call it as typecasting that we have discussed, I think, inside your second unit. Typecasting. So simply, this PTR, it is a generic pointer. So we have to convert that generic value into specific integer value. Specific integer address, generic address to specific integer address. So how we can? Simply by typecasting int star. So now this PTR value, PTR address will become integer address. If you indirect that integer address, you will get 20 value. So A is equals to 20 you will get. Then we are storing C, character address, into that PTR, and we are typecasting and we are getting the address of C, value of C. If you indirect the address of character, you will get the value of that character variable. So that is the thing, but A you got in the output. So arrays and pointers, there is a very important relationship between arrays and pointers that you have to understand. So quickly I will explain that also. Okay, so what is an array? We discussed this thing. Arrays, we discussed integer, how we can declare a of 4. So this is a normal array declaration I have done over here. A normal array declaration, and I will assign the values as well for your clear understanding. And I'm making the values as 2, 4, 6, 8. How many values I'm initializing? I'm initializing like 4 values. And how the memory representation will be, that memory representation also I will take. This is your first element. It is second, third, and fourth. How the indexing will start, that also you know. This is your A of 0. Okay, this is your A of 1. And this is your A of 2. And this last one is your A of 3. Because array indexing will start from 0 and ends with maximum size minus 1. Your maximum size is 4. And the if you do minus 1, you will get this 3. So what the content over here? This is 2. Okay. And this is your 4. And this is your 6. And this last thing is value 8. So like this you will get. So in the definition itself, in the array definition itself, we said array is a collection of elements of same data type, isn't it? Array is a contiguous memory locations collection. Okay, array elements, all array elements will be contiguous in nature. Contiguous in the sense they will be one after the other. So whatever addresses they are going to have over here. So let us say the first memory location's address is 14,000. Then automatically your second memory location's address will become 14,001. So then the second memory location, that is third memory location's address will become 14,002. Okay. And then 14,003. This is something like all houses in a street, in a single street, all houses in a sequential order. Then if you see the house numbers, how they will increment, okay, how they will increment all house addresses by one only, isn't it? If one house address is one, I mean, flat number 1000 in the sense, then ultimately the consecutive, the adjacent flat number will become 1001, and another adjacent 1002, another adjacent 1003, likewise. Okay, all these memory locations are contiguous memory locations. They are one after the other. Okay, joint memory locations, we can say. So if you declare an array, all you will get, all memory locations you will get contiguously. Okay, so array is a contiguous collection of contiguous memory locations. Array is a collection of contiguous memory locations of same type. In that sense, you just remember this definition. Array is a collection of contiguous memory locations of same type. Okay, all memory locations are contiguous in nature. So there is one more important relation between the pointers and arrays. We have that array name, if you put just the array name, okay, array name will give you the address of first memory location. This will give you the address of first memory location, address of first memory location. Okay, so array name will give you the address of first memory location, address of first memory location. This you have to remember. So if you have a normal variable int a, now a is my normal variable, So if I take A, what it will give you? This will not give you the address, isn't it? Being a regular variable, A will give you only the value. Only the value what A is holding. But being an array name, over here A is what? It is an array name. In this scenario, A is my array name. In this scenario, A is a normal variable. If it is a normal variable, A will give you the value. A will give you what? It will give you the value. So that I will write over here. It will give you the value. But over here, what it is giving? It is giving the address of the first memory location. So what is that address? 14,000. When you say A, it will represent the 14,000. So now, keeping this statement in mind, in your mind, array name will give you the address of the first memory location. So now, what we can do? So if you want to access the address, I mean the value of this first location, how you can access value? Simply apply the indirection. So how you can get that value? So shall we do one simple program with this one? Yeah, to understand very clearly. Yeah, this concept you just keep like this only, and I will open. This is your Dave CPP. So I'm taking a simple file. So hash include stdio.h. Okay, then int main of void. Okay, then open parenthesis, close parenthesis. I'm declaring an array, the same array, A equals A of 4. Equals to, I'm initializing values as well, 2 comma 6 comma 8, sorry, 4 comma 8, 4 comma 6 comma 8. So I have initialized the values. Then okay, put your CLR SCR, that is nothing but system of CLS, system of CLS. So next thing, so as I said, array name will give you the address of the first memory location. So there are two ways to print the first memory location's value, %d, %d. Okay. So first thing, with the help of direct indexing, how I can apply, how I can print this first location's value, that you already know, A of 0. A of 0 will give you the value of the first location. So that is nothing but 2 you will get, isn't it? So I will remove this. Okay, I will remove this, and we will see what output you will get for this program. Today it is 31st, so I'm saving test.c. Hit enter. Now the program is saved. Execute, compile. Compilation successful. No, he's saying something. Okay, here I forgot to put the semicolon. Semicolon I kept. Now save, compile. Okay, compilation successful. Then execute, run. So see what value you got. The first location's value you got. That value is nothing but 2. So as you can see, the first location's value, A of 0 in the sense, first location's value, 2 we got. So next thing what I want to do is, the same value I want to print with the help of address. Okay, we said the array name, A will give you the address of the first location. If you go over here and see, I said address of the first memory location. A is nothing but address of the first memory location. So if you have the address of first memory location, what you have to do in order to get the value from that first location, simply apply star A. So star A will give you the value of the first location, isn't it? So value of the first location, this star A is nothing but your value of the first location that you already know. If you apply the star on the address, you will get the value. So here, value of the first memory location. Okay, value of the first memory location. So that we will check. Quickly we'll go to this and we will check. So here, what I have to do, same thing I want to print, but with the help of address. So what I have to do, star A, that's it. Star A will give you the address of the first look, I mean value of the first location. Save that one, execute, compile, done, execute, run. See this one, we got the same thing, 2, 2. So that means it is giving the value of the first location. A of 0 is also giving the value of the first location. Star A is also giving the value of the first location. So in that way. So I told you that all memory locations are contiguous in nature. Contiguous in the sense one after the other. So their memory addresses also have shown 14,000, 14,001, 14,002, 14,003. So now from here to here to jump, how many memory locations? Only one memory location. So you can add one to that first memory location address to get the second memory location's address. So how I can show that one? Simply put, A plus 1. So now A plus 1 is what? A plus 1 is address of second memory location, isn't it? Second memory location, address of second memory location. A plus 1 is address of second memory location. So to get the value, apply star on A plus 1. So like this, if you do like this, you will get the value of second memory location. Second memory location, because all memory locations are contiguous in nature. Then how to get the third memory location, that is A of 2? Simply add A plus 2. A plus 2 will give you the address of third memory location. Address of third memory location. This thing we don't need, right? This thing we don't need, so I will remove this one. I will remove this one. Then quickly go here and take this address of third memory location. A plus 2 in the sense, third memory location. Okay, this is your third memory location. Address of third memory location. So how to get the value of third memory location? Star A plus 2. If you do like this, you will get the, okay, what you will get? You will get the value of third memory location. Okay, that I am writing over here. Value of third memory location. That's it. Okay, so the last location, that is four. Third location, how you can get? I mean, the fourth location, how you can get? A plus 4. A plus 4 will give you address of what? Fourth memory location. Address of fourth memory location. So how to get the value from the fourth memory location? Simply apply asterisk of A plus 4 will give you the value of fourth memory location. Simply applying the asterisk will give you the value. Don't apply asterisk, will give you address. So A will give you the address of the first memory location, that is 14,000. If you add 1 to that, it will give you the address of the second memory location. Add 2 to that will give you the address of the third memory location. Add 3 to that will give you the address of the fourth memory location. So applying asterisk on that address will give you the values. So asterisk of A plus 1 will give you the value of second memory location. So asterisk of A plus 2 will give you the value of the third memory location. Asterisk of A plus 3 here, not 4. I have done a mistake over here. It is A plus 3. It should be 3. And it should be 3 only. Here not 4 but 3. Just put 3. This is 3. Okay, here you put 3 and here also 3. That's it. Okay, so this first memory location's address when I got, so you can put the first memory location, how can? A plus 0. Standardize the stuff because every time we are adding some content. So to this is A plus 0 is nothing but adding 0 to address. So it will remain as it is. So address of first memory location. First memory location. Adding 0 to it will give you the address of the first memory location. Okay. So in this way, there is no space to put this one, so I will put like this only. Okay, so adding, I mean applying asterisks will give you the address of the first location. Oh, sorry, value of the first location. Apply asterisk of A plus 0 will give you value of first memory location. In this way, you can get all the possibilities from your array. The only one statement that you have to remember over here is this one. With this thing only, we have elaborated this much. Address of first memory location. Array name will give you the address of first memory location. From there only we have elaborated this much. Understood? So quickly we'll go and we'll see that complete program. Okay. So over here, A of 0 is nothing but asterisk of A plus 0. So like this. This will give you the value from the first location. So how you can get the value from the second location? Control C. Here you put. This is your first location. We are printing first location over here. So same thing, how you can get from the second location? Second location equals to. So what you have to do? Add 1. A of 1 is nothing but your second location. So here you have to add 1. A plus 1 will give you the address of second location, and applying asterisks will give you the value of second location. Same thing. For third location, how we can do? Here, in place of second, put third. Put third. Then third location equals to, what you have to do? A of 2. Third location in the sense, A of 2. So then, to get the address, A plus 2. To get the value, asterisk of A plus 2. The final location, the fourth location. Okay. Fourth location. How we can get the fourth location value? A of 3. And this is A plus 3. So in this way we can. So over here, whatever operation we are performing, addition operation we are performing. So these additions, we call it as pointer arithmetic. Pointer arithmetic. There are two ways to access your array elements. There are two ways to access your array elements. One is with the help of indexing. This is nothing but your indexing. Using the subscript is nothing but your indexing. One is with the help of indexing, we can access the array elements. The second thing is with the help of pointer arithmetic also, we can access the array elements. Pointer arithmetic, it is very simple. Array name will give you the address of the first memory location. Adding 0 will retain same. Where you have started, there only you will start. Then adding 1 will take you to the next location. Okay, the second location. Adding 2 will take you to the third location. Adding 3 will take you to the fourth location. Likewise, going to that location, applying the asterisk will give you the value from that location. So in that way, in order to access the value from the first location, what we are doing? A of 0 asterisk. Then in order to access the value from the second location, A plus 1, applying asterisk. Then A plus 2, asterisk. A plus 3, asterisk. In that way, we are accessing all the values. So quickly check. I have in my array, I have first value as 2, second value as 4. third value as 6 and fourth value as 8. The same values we have to get in the output. Compilation successful. Then go to run and see the output. Sorry. Yeah, here you can see. Okay, I have not taken the backslash n. So it is printing that complete stuff inside a single line. So what I have to do, I have to take backslash n's. Backslash n here, here, here also. Then go and save. First we have to compile the program. So execute, compile, compilation successful. Then execute and run. Check here. I don't know why it is happening like this. Okay. Then check. First location, 2, 2 we got. One with the help of indexing and one with the help of pointer arithmetic. Second location, indexing, pointer arithmetic. Third location, indexing, pointer arithmetic. Fourth location, indexing, pointer arithmetic. In that way, we have printed all the address, all the values from your array. Clear? Hopefully this concept is clear. It is a very important concept. What are the ways to access the array elements in C? There are two ways. One with the help of indexing and other with the help of pointer arithmetic. The two ways we have seen. So quickly we'll go to our slides and we'll see. Arrays and pointers we have discussed. So this is what? The name of the array is a pointer constant to the first element. So A is same like %A of 0. A is same like %A of 0. Then *A is same like A of 0. So that is what? A will give you the address of the first location. Or if you have the index A of 0, apply the % will give you the address of the first location. So the same thing they have explained over here. So the next thing, yeah, this just now we have done first location address, first location value. Just now I have done that program. So the next thing, pointer arithmetic and arrays. Just now I have explained. Okay, besides indexing, programmers use another powerful method of moving through an array. That is nothing but pointer arithmetic. There are two ways in which we can access the array elements. One is with the help of indexing and another with the help of pointer arithmetic. Pointer arithmetic, just now I have explained. Adding the integers to your addresses will take you to the next locations in your array, because all array elements are contiguous to one and another. All array elements are contiguous to each other. They will stand side by side inside your memory. That is the reason why you can simply apply the pointer arithmetic to get all the locations from your array. Okay. So the next thing. Okay, one dimensional array that we have already discussed, isn't it? P+1 will take you to the next second location. P+2 will take you to the third location. P+3 will take you to the fourth location in that way. Okay, having a pointer to an array. So I have to explain this also. Yeah, here you can see many things I have to remove. Yeah, this entire thing I will remove. This is my 14,000. Okay, this is my 14,000. Clear? So now A of 4 I have declared, and this is my memory representation to that array. So far I have not done anything. So now what I am doing, I am taking a pointer of type integer, int *ptr. Okay, so after this what I am doing, ptr equals to %A of. And %A of 2. So what my PTR is going to hold now? This is my PTR. This is my PTR. What this PTR will hold now? When I say ampersand of A of 2, what is A of 2? This second memory location is A of 2. This second memory location is A of 2. Sorry, third memory location is A of 2. So when you apply this ampersand on that third memory location, what it will give? It will give the address of that third memory location. It will give the address of that third memory location. So what is that address? 14,002 is that address. So you will get that address inside this pointer. You will get this address inside this pointer. So if you get this address, ultimately, where this pointer will point, this pointer will point to this memory location. Isn't it? This pointer will point to this memory location. Like this, it will point. This PTR is pointing to this memory location, this third memory location inside your array. So next thing, just give me a second. Okay, so next what I am doing, how I can move using this pointer, how I can move back and forth inside this array. So if I add PTR equals to PTR plus 1, or suppose let us say if I want to print printf, so that is percentile d. Percentile d, comma, printf percentile d star ptr. So like this, if I do, what I will get over here? Star ptr will give you what? What I will get over here? Okay, it will give you the value. Okay, ptr is holding the address of third location. So it will, star ptr will give you the value from this third location. That value is nothing but what? 6. You will get 6 over here. In that sense, you remember, you will get 6 over there. Clear? So the next thing, if I want to print the value from the first location, what I have to do? Print f percentile d, comma. Okay, what I have to put? I need value. What I have to put? PTR is holding the address of third location. How many values I have to subtract from that PTR to get the first memory location's address? 2 I have to subtract, isn't it? That 2 I will subtract now. And per star PTR minus 2. PTR minus 2. So now, PTR is holding what? PTR is holding 14,000. So if I do minus 14,002, PTR is holding 14,002. If I do minus 2, then PTR's content will become 14,000. 14,000 is nothing but your first location address. So if you apply indirection on first memory location's address, if you apply indirection on 14,000, you will get this 2 over here, isn't it? So you will get 2 over here. So this 2 you will get on the output screen. Clear? So the next thing, if I want to print this last location's value, the fourth location value, what I have to do? Last location's value, what I have to do? Simply printf percentile d, okay, comma, star of PTR plus what? 1, isn't it? Because already PTR is holding what? PTR is holding 14,002. To print the last location value, I need the address 14,003. So just add 1. So adding 1 will take you to here. So now, if I write like this, I will get the last location's address. So that last location's address, applying indirection, will give you the last location value, percentile D, last location's value, that is 8. So I can make a statement over here. If this is your PTR, then this will become your PTR plus 1, isn't it? This will become your PTR plus 1, and this will become your PTR itself. Okay, this will become your PTR minus 1. PTR minus 1, and this last one will become your PTR minus 2. This way you have to remember. Hopefully you got the answer, I mean you got this concept, how pointer arithmetic can be used in order to index your array. In order to move back and forth inside your array, we have two options. One is with the help of indexing we can do, and the other one with the help of what? With the help of pointer arithmetic we can do. Another with the help of pointer arithmetic we can do. So having an address like this, PTR is pointing over here. Na? So now this PTR, with the help of not, with the, how to get the value? Value you can get by simply applying the star. This will give you the address. Value how you can get? By applying star of PTR plus 1. Here, star of PTR plus 0. Isn't it? Because to standardize the stuff, we are adding 0 over here. Adding 0 will not make any change in the value that you already know. So PTR will hold here 14,002. Adding 0 will also make 14,002. Applying star will give you the value. Here how we can do? Here PTR star of PTR minus 1. PTR minus 1. Here the last one, how we can do? This is star of PTR minus 2. Like this we can get the values. This is addresses, this is values. So now with the help of indexing, when PTR is pointing to this A of 2, how we can get with the help of indexing? So this is nothing but, this will become, as PTR is pointing to this location, this will become your PTR of 0. You can do like this. This is your PTR of 0. This is your PTR of 1. PTR of 1. So this is your, this is what? PTR of minus 1. This will become your PTR of minus 1. Okay. This is your PTR of minus 2. PTR of minus 2. So in this way also you can access all the elements from your array with the help of indexing. Hopefully you understood this concept perfectly. So this is one thing. So this is how we can access one-dimensional array, in the sense simply by adding or subtracting the pointers. Here see, given a pointer PTR, you can either put plus n. N is nothing but your integer values. Plus n or minus 1 is a pointer to the value n elements away from the pointer. Okay, this in last statement, I have given the explanation. Okay, so here the same thing, A is pointing over here, A plus 1 will point the immediate element, next element, last element, likewise. Okay, in my example, I have taken up to this only, A of 3 only, A plus 3 only, A plus 4 we have not done. But here in this diagram, I have taken A plus 4 as well, and fifth element, I made it as 22. So if you are assigning your P to the second element, then P minus 1 will become your first element, P plus 1 will become your third element, P plus 2, fourth element, P plus 3, fifth element, in that way. So this is same thing, A of 0 or asterisk of A of plus 1. So the same thing I have explained over there as well. Okay. So this is the simple program to print all those values. That's it. Okay. So in that sense, pointer arithmetic is also one of the ways to manipulate the elements inside your array. So inside your array, how you can access the elements, all your elements, means we have two ways. One is with the help of indexing, and the other one with the help of pointer arithmetic. This explanation, whatever I have given on this paints on this slide, you have to understand it very thoroughly. If you have any doubts, you can post in the comment section. And moreover, why you guys are not posting your attendance? Many of them, they have not posted the attendance. I don't know. So simply post your attendance so that we can give the attendance to you. Post your roll numbers in the comment section so that we can give the attendance to you. Okay, hopefully you understood this concept, all these concepts perfectly. You can watch this video afterwards, and if you have any doubts, you can ask me at any time. You can post the doubts in the comment section. Okay, inshallah, very soon I will take another class So in that class, we'll be discussing the recursion, structures, and files. These three concepts we have to discuss. Recursion, structures, and files. Only these three concepts from your fifth unit, they are pending. Once we complete these three concepts, your entire syllabus will be completed. Okay? Okay, thank you very much. Post your attendance in the comment section. And stay safe. Be at home. Thank you very much.